We've been together for a while now. We're growing stronger every day now. It feels so good and there is no doubt I will stay with you. As each morning brings a sunrise and the flowers bloom in springtime, on my loving you can rely and I'll stay with you. There'll be heartaches and pain, yes it will.
Got a Bible, I want you to go to Mark chapter 6. If you don't have a Bible, the words are going to be on the screen. They're also on your message notes that they just passed out to you. While you're doing that, let me remind you that 4 weeks from today is Easter Sunday. Isn't that amazing? That means winter is almost over. Just hold on. And Easter's around the corner. I just want to encourage you to invite people to church Easter weekend. It's the most likely time that people would be willing to come to church than any other time. And we are planning an incredible Easter weekend with the theme of impossible. We're going to be telling three stories of people in our church whom God has done the impossible in their lives. And you're going to want to invite everybody you know and even people you don't know to come to church with you on Easter weekend, okay? So I want to encourage you to be praying about that. Okay, we have been in this series, Stronger. Next Sunday, we're going to be talking about stronger parents and children, and so that's going to be a great day next week, because at the end of both services, we're going to dedicate babies, dedicate kids. So if you have a baby or a child that hasn't been dedicated to the Lord, next Sunday is your day. On your way out today at the information desk, there is a form for you to fill out if you'd like them to be part of that, and we'll get in contact with this week with all the details, but we'd like to invite you to be part of our baby dedication service, okay? Okay, Pastor Wayne, okay, let's go. Stronger men. Now, before we can talk about stronger men, we got to do a little bit of a review when we talked about stronger women last Sunday. Probably the single most talked about message so far this year. So we'll see, ladies, if you will repeat this one today. All right. Anyway, let's talk a little bit what we talked about last week. We made some observations. God made men and women differently on purpose. Have you noticed that men and women are different? The Bible says God made them male and female, so whose idea was it for us to be different? It was God's idea. He did that on purpose. Well, why did he do that? Well, he created marriage to teach us to love somebody not like us. Some of you are having deep revelation. You mean, that's right, she's not like me. And she's not supposed to be like you. He's not supposed to be like you, ladies. Come on, somebody. And then God created marriage to make us godly, not make us happy. I mean, a lot of people are looking to get married so they'll be happy. God created marriage so that we could grow up. And how many know when people grow up, they become happy? Immature people aren't very happy. But when we grow, it makes us happy. And so this is God's plan, God's design for us, okay? So we're going to talk about stronger men today and what men need to make them stronger. So before we talk about what men want, let's talk about what men don't want. Men don't want to be women. At least the ones I know, right? If you were here a couple weekends ago with Mark Gunger, he was talking about this in the marriage weekend. He says, many times when women describe the perfect man, especially a perfect husband, they might say things like this: a guy who appreciates the details of life, a guy who loves to talk and open up to his feelings, someone who remembers all the details of life, all the things that are important to them, and someone who would share with them about the day rather than stare at the TV all night. But in short, they have just described their favorite girlfriend. Come on, somebody. Men make terrible girlfriends. Terrible. Yeah. Now listen, men tend to not like to talk. Now I was reminded last week when we were talking about the how a woman needs communication, some men are like that. I get that, but for the most part, men don't like to talk. Men tend to forget details. Men tend to not open up and discuss their feelings. Men conquer. Men protect. Men compete. Men work. Men make disgusting noises with their bodies. Come on, somebody. But we generally do not share our feelings. We can now, how many know we can learn to do that? That's what we talked about last week. If you missed last week's message, man, you need to rewind and make sure you read that, because we've got to learn to communicate with women in our lives. And so today, I want to talk to you about this big idea. It's pretty important. A woman has the keys to a man's heart. A woman has the keys to a man's heart. And just a little bit of a preview, I had a 90-year-old lady on her way out the door of the 9 o'clock service said, "Pastor, I wish I'd heard this 70 years ago." Praise God for that. A woman has the keys to a man's heart. Now, what does that mean? What are we going to talk about? Well, that could mean a lot of things. We could today talk about companionship, that God created women and men for companionship, right? The Bible says it is not good for man to be alone. Anybody remember reading that? So he says, I'll make a helper or a companion for him. And how many know, ladies, it's not good to leave guys alone for long periods of time anyway, right? Men without women, it's not a good thing, right? And so we could talk about that. We could talk about sex, and we're going to do that in a couple Sundays, how to be successful. But, you know, obviously, we're talking about married men here, but because God created sex for marriage. And if you've been reading the one-year Bible, especially this last week in the book of Leviticus, don't have sex with this person, don't have sex with this person, don't have sex with them, don't have sex with them. How about don't have sex with anybody if you're not married to them, right? All sex outside of marriage leads to death in the Old Testament. Wow, so we'll talk about what that means in a couple weeks, but I'm not going to talk about that today. I want to talk to you about the number one need of every man. Anybody know what it is? Honor. Every man needs and wants honor in their life. I want to start in Mark chapter 6, and I want to show you a few examples from Scripture how this works. Jesus left there and went to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. Where did this man get these things, they asked. What's this wisdom that has been given to him? What are these remarkable miracles he's performing? Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? He's saying, didn't our kids go to kindergarten with this guy? We know this man. And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without what? Honor, except in his own town or his own house, among his relatives and in his own home. He could not do any miracles there except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. Now, I want you to notice, the Bible does not say that Jesus would not do any miracles there. It says he could not do any miracles there in his hometown. Now, that's pretty amazing. Because Jesus was a man. He was fully God. He was 100% God. He was 100% man. And so he operated through faith like we do. But these verses say that the people in his hometown didn't have faith in him. How do we know that? Or why did that happen? Well, we see it in the scripture because they did not honor him. Now, their dishonor of Jesus kept him from doing great things in their lives. Their dishonor of Jesus inhibited Jesus from doing great things for them, in them. Are you seeing this? This is important. Now, if dishonor hindered Jesus when he was a man, could dishonor hinder the men in your life from also doing great things? Now, ladies, it's possible that you are living with a potentially great man. But without honor, he may be hindered from doing all that God has called him to do and all that God has empowered him to do. Ladies, you just might hold the key to his greatness. Because honor is the most important need that every man has. God has wired them that way. Now, we talked last week about when a man communicates with a woman. Remember, when we communicate, we just exchange information. But when you're communicating with a woman, guys, you've got to communicate with nuance and feeling. It's not just about what you say, it's how you say and the tone in which you say it. How many know, ladies, when it comes to honor, it's the same way for women toward men. It's not just what you say, it's how you say it. Now, we've been doing the Family Project on Wednesday nights. I'd love for you to join us if you can. It's a campaign by Focus on the Family to help people learn to think correctly again about what a family is and why God created men and women. It's fascinating stuff. But in their chapter talking about men, it says this: good men aren't born, they're made. Would you agree with that? Good men aren't born. They're not just born good. They are made by their families, by their mom and dad, by their churches, by their culture, right? Good men can be made. And so it's our prayer today, what does it take to make a good man? Now, we're going to go back to the Old Testament in Judges chapter 6 here, and I want to show you an illustration, several illustrations really, from the Bible that this statement is true, that good men aren't born, they are made. We're going to start with a story of Gideon in the Old Testament. Now, let me set the stage here for this story. Gideon was during the time of the Judges. So if you go back, Israel's come out of Egypt. Moses had led them through the wilderness. Moses had died. Joshua had taken them into the promised land. And so now there's this ongoing battle of possessing the promised land, and they're fighting against Israel's enemies. Now, during this time of Gideon's time, during the time of the Judges, the enemies of Israel were having the upper hand. Matter of fact, the enemies of Israel were terrorizing the Israelites. They would sneak in and burn their crops. When they harvested crops, they would destroy them. They were just making life miserable on the Israelites. And so that's the stage that we read this. Judges 6, verse 11 through 13. The angel of the Lord came and sat down under the oak in, it's not Oprah, I'm just making sure you're paying attention, Oprah's not in the Bible, Ophrah, that belonged to Joash the Abizrite, where his son Gideon was threshing wheat in a wine press to keep it from the Midianites. What was he doing? He was hiding. Okay? When the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, he said, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." Wow, that's a good day. When an angel shows up and says that about you, man, every man wants that. Let's keep going. Gideon says, "Pardon me, my Lord, but if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all his wonders that our ancestors told us about when they said, 'Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt?' But now the Lord has abandoned us and given us into the hand of Midian." Now, hold on a second. He's not acting much like a warrior right there, is he? He's acting a little bit like a coward. The angel comes to him and says, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." Gideon kind of goes, me? Are you kidding me? Lord, I don't get it. I don't understand. Matter of fact, as we go on down to the next verse, look at what he says. He says to the angel, please, Lord, how can I save Israel? Behold, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. Now, he's not acting like a warrior. He's acting a little bit like a wimp here, saying, who, me? I can't do this. This is not possible in my life. He's acting more like a coward. And after the angel calls him out, remember, he's just not convinced. And so he asked the angel for fleece before the Lord. Three different signs before he'll take up what the angel says and begin to lead Israel into battle. Now, I think the story of Gideon illustrates something that every woman needs to know about men here today. Mark Gunger writes it in his book, Laugh Your Way to a Better Marriage. Look at what he says. Most women are not aware of this, but the majority of men feel very unsure of themselves. In a recent survey, 75% of men admitted they feel like an imposter. Many spend their entire lives fighting the voices in their head that constantly shout, you don't really know what you're doing. It's just a matter of time before everyone discovers you're a fake, you're a fraud. A man's home should be the one place in his life where these voices are silenced, where he is assured he is wonderful and competent. Sadly, for millions of men, their home is a place where the voices of criticism are amplified, not silenced. I heard one woman say to her husband, who had just received a special plaque at an awards banquet, everyone thinks you're so great, but I know what an idiot you are. I don't think any man in this room would ever admit that this is true. But let me tell you, it's true. And that's why every man needs an angel calling out the warrior in their lives. For some guys, it could be your mom. It could be your wife. For some, it's your sister. Maybe it's a teacher, a coach, or a boss. I don't know. Hopefully, it's all of the above. But ladies, here's what I want to encourage you with today. You are more equipped to do this than anybody else. God has given you the keys to a man's heart. And our culture doesn't understand this, does it? We do the exact opposite. Matter of fact, some women make the mistake that thinking if they insult their husbands, that will get them to change. What's the matter with you? Why can't you do anything around here, they might say. Women who do this assume that their criticisms and rejections are properly received by men, and that as a result, because they're criticizing them, that they will change their character and their faults and make them better men. But every man in this room will tell you that the exact opposite is true, that criticism and rejection only create anger and frustration in the heart of a man. There's a few verses in the Bible that illustrate this. I'm just going to show you one. From Proverbs chapter 21, verse 9. Better to live on the corner of a roof than to share a house with a nagging wife. I'm just going to let that sit there for a moment. Pastor, that's not in the Bible. That is in the Bible. There's a few versions of that one verse in Proverbs. And I realize this is a very dangerous time for all the guys, so be careful, guys. Doesn't this verse illustrate exactly what we're talking about? It reinforces the truth of what we're saying. Ladies, if you want your husband or your sons or your bosses or your brothers, if you want the men in your life to respond to you, criticism is not the way to do it. Honor is. Now, ladies, I understand why you would do this because, listen, if you criticize a woman is going to take that personally and attempt to do something about it. She'll try to change. It will drive her crazy until she changes. Now, and the thing is, here's another reason why we're talking about this. Men are not like women. And they don't respond the same way. And so, guys, instead of responding with change, you lose our heart when you do things like that. Now, the whole world can think that your husband is the best of the best of the best in this or that or the other, but if his wife doesn't think so, all of the other accolades means very little. Nothing can replace the power of honor a woman can bring to a man. Nothing. Guys, let me ask you a question. What will a man do for a woman that honors him? Almost anything. What will a man do for a woman that honors him? Almost anything. See, Pastor, you don't know the guy I live with. Pastor, you don't understand. Listen, I understand you might have to do this by faith. You may have to speak it before it comes to pass. You might have to give it before it's earned. Didn't the angel of the Lord do that for Gideon in this story? Come on, somebody. But that's not the only time God did this. God did this several times in men's lives in the Bible. And listen, if there's anybody had a right to criticize, had a right to, or knew the characters and flaws of men and just to beat them down for it, God could do that. But I want you to notice what God does in the life of Abraham. Remember, Abraham, this man of faith, right? What does he do when things get kind of squirrely? And he's very afraid of Pharaoh, that Pharaoh's going to take Sarah to be his wife. So what does Abraham do? He lies. Oh, she's my sister. That's crazy. He's a coward. But does God call him a coward? No, God calls him a father of faith. That's pretty amazing. And isn't that what Abraham became? Yeah. Matter of fact, God called Abraham the father of many nations. And God called Abraham the father of many nations before he had kids. Remember, in that culture, having children, especially lots of children, was the ultimate sign of respect and honor in that culture. So God calls Abraham a father of many nations. He gives him the respect due a patriarch long before he ever was one. Do you get this? God called Abraham who he was before he was that. He did it the same for Gideon. God calls the warrior out of Gideon before he ever becomes a warrior. Come on, somebody. And what about Peter in the New Testament? Simon Peter. Peter was a flip-flopping, emotional guy with an anger problem, right? He wasn't sure of himself. He said stupid stuff, and he had the tendency to fly off the handle. The same guy who said, "Jesus, I will die for you." It wasn't very long after that, he wilts under the pressure, the peer pressure of a teenage girl. But what does Jesus call Simon? He says, "I'm going to give you a new name, Peter." The original word, Petra, which means rock. God called Peter his new name before all of this stuff ever happened. But did Peter go on to become the rock, the foundation of the New Testament church? Absolutely. Do you see a pattern in Scripture here? You know, I don't understand it, ladies, but God has created in men an innate need for affirmation. It's kind of sad, I know, but that's how God's made us. It's how He's wired us. Matter of fact, psychologists have confirmed this is true. If you've ever read the book, The Five Love Languages, anybody ever read the book, The Five Love Languages? If you haven't read it, it's for sale out in the bookstore table there in the hub. I would highly encourage you to read that because Gary Chapman, the author, illustrates that everybody has a love language or the way you give love and the way you receive love. And he's described five different love languages that men and women speak. The first one is giving gifts. Some people, that's how they speak love. That's how they give love. Some is quality time. Some are physical touch. Some are words of affirmation. Some are acts of service. And some of you already know what your primary love language is. And if this is confusion to you in any way, just Google Dr. Gary Chapman, The Five Love Languages. You take the assessment. By the end of the day, you will know what your love language is. Okay? Now, but in the book, he states that for the majority of men, their two primary love languages in most men, not all men, but in most men are physical touch and words of affirmation. That's how most men give love and receive love, physical touch and words of affirmation, which explains why all those fourth grade boys are punching those fourth grade. Never mind, sorry. It reminds me of a story, which, never mind. I gotta let that go, let it go, let it go. Okay, here we go. Back to story. Years ago, before Tracy and I came to pastor this church, we were transitioning out of another church that we were serving as youth pastors in. And so before we left to come here, so this would have been, what, 18, 19 years ago, one of the ladies on staff at the church sat me down. She wanted to give me some advice. And she said, Wayne, when you go pastor that church, I want you to remember this. She said, remember that church members are like dogs. That's what she said. She said, you can beat us, you can yell at us, you can kick us, but because we're loyal, we'll come back home. She said, but remember this, if you're nice to us, you feed us, and you pet us, we'll do flips for you. Which pretty much explains my philosophy of ministry. You know, it makes a lot of sense to me. We'll do flips for you. Now, guys, isn't it pretty much the same for us? Guys, it's kind of sad. Guys, but aren't we like dogs also? Pat us on the head. Go ahead and mess up our hair or rub our bellies. Touch us anywhere, really. You know, we'll respond to it, you know. Atta boy! That's a good boy! That's a good dog. I mean, boy. That's all we need. Maybe some food. Food would be good. Come on, somebody, right? Listen, we're good. That's how men respond. Now, the reason is because a lot of us here are a lot like Gideon. We're unsure of ourselves. We need somebody to call us out, to call the warrior inside of us out of us. We need that in our lives. And ladies, God has uniquely suited you more than anybody else to do this. Other people can do it. Men can do it. Fathers can do it. Everybody can do it. But somehow, God has given you a unique ability to do this in your life. Now, let me pause for a second and bring a little bit of balance to this, because this does not mean, ladies, that you can't challenge the men in your lives. But you can do so with respect. Matter of fact, there are lots of men that need to be challenged by some strong women to be encouraged to be stronger than they are. They need you to believe in them. But mom, don't create lifelong adolescents who never take responsibility for their lives. Challenge them and watch them grow and flourish. You know, if your teenage boy or your young adult son doesn't take responsibility, don't coddle the boy. Don't baby him. Tell him you're better than that. God has called you to be a man. It's time to stop being a boy. Be a man of God. Amen? I know you can do better. God's called you to something else. Don't settle for mediocrity when God has called you to excellence. Amen? Mark Gunger wrote a powerful story in his book. He says, strong women don't tolerate irresponsibility from the men in their lives. I often hear reports from women who tell me of how their man stays out till 2 a.m. without calling their wives, or how he entertains old girlfriends or goes out with his buddies instead of spending time with the family. Then they ask in a soft voice, an insecure voice, they ask me, what can I do? That's when I sit there and for a moment and ask myself, why don't I treat my wife that way? The answer is straightforward and always the same. I don't, because my wife would kill me. And all the men should amen. Ladies, if your husband is staying out all hours of the night, perhaps he's flirtatious with other women, you don't honor that man. You challenge that man. You put his clothes on the porch and invite him to go live with his mommy and his daddy, because he is clearly not yet a man. A real man takes responsibility. Ladies, you should not tolerate irresponsible behavior of the men in your lives. But God can use you to help challenge them to grow and be responsible. Somebody say amen. Okay, so let's bring it in for a landing. But right before we pray, I want to show you five ways to honor a man. Five tips for honoring men in your life, okay? Write these down. Number one, if you want to honor a man, the first one is easy. Praise. Men thrive on praise. That's a good boy. Attaboy. Listen, honor your husband, ladies, and he will rise to the occasion. How many know the old saying goes, behind every great man is a surprised wife? You ever heard that? But I believe the opposite is true. Behind every great man is an honoring wife. That's how it works. And so, again, men are like dogs. We're not complicated. Now, females are complicated. Men are not complicated. You know, we thrive on praise. That's a good boy. Here's number two. Men, you need to know this, ladies, that men are not tough emotionally. There's a reason why God didn't choose men to have babies.
Yeah, amen.
Now, listen, men might be tough physically, but they're not tough emotionally. Now, women are sensitive physically, aren't they? At least most women. Now, I learned this right after we were married. Tracy and I were first married because I grew up in a house with three brothers, you know, various and sundry foster kids. We wrestled a lot. I found out real early that Tracy did not like to wrestle. Ladies, as sensitive as you are physically, he's that sensitive emotionally. Now, why is that? Because, guys, if we're honest, men are emotionally shallow. Men don't have deep conversations. Now, guys, when we get together, what do we talk about? Sports? Guns? Cars? Sports? Shooting stuff, right? What are we not talking about? How's it going at home? How do you feel? What do you feel? No. We shallow conversations. That's us. Ladies, you don't have those types of conversations. You're always talking about your feelings and you're communicating. Guys, it's very, very shallow. And because that's who we are. Women have deeper conversations, but men are not tough emotionally. Listen, ladies, men would rather take a literal punch in the face from another guy rather than to receive a dishonoring word from his wife. Are you getting this? Here's number three. Don't cut him down or compare him to other men. When you cut your husband, your son down in front of other people, it's the most damage you can do to a relationship. Now, whatever you want to say to him may be true, but I want to remind you what Proverbs 31 says about a virtuous woman. In verse 23, it says, her husband is respected at the city gate. Number four, men want to live in houses where they're praised. Psalm 22, verse 3, you guys, we sing this. The Lord inhabits the praises of his people. Well, guess what? Men are made in his image. We like to live in houses where we're praised. Are you getting this? Which some guy said, you know what? Yeah, Pastor, I read in 2 Peter that Sarah called Abraham Lord. And here's what your wife's thinking. Well, if I was married to Abraham, I would praise him. But I'm married to Jim Bob, and he's about to kill us. So what that means is you've got to honor him for who you see him to be, for what God has called him to be. I'm telling you, it will change your life, it will change your family, it will change your relationships, and yes, it will take faith to do that. Some of you have probably heard of the book Love and Respect by Dr. Emerson and Sarah Egricks. He talks about this a lot in his book. I want to show you one quote from The Language of Love and Respect. He says, "The man with basic goodwill wants to serve his wife, and he would even die for her. When his wife shows him unconditional respect, in most cases, he will feel like a prince and be motivated to show her the kind of unconditional love she desires. She is a princess who is loved." Ladies, what I'm trying to tell you, if this is the key to a man's heart. Now, everybody's got their own responsibilities, and we're not talking about manipulation. We're talking about being obedient to what God has called us to do. Amen? Here's number five, last one, and we're going to pray. Don't talk about his faults to friends or family. One of the worst things that happens in church is women talk about their husbands to their girlfriends. But then their girlfriends tell their husbands, who end up telling him. And relationships are fractured. And then we wonder sometimes why men hate going to church. Are you hearing me today? Now, I know that everything I'm saying today and everything I said last week to the guys about women is completely opposite the culture that you and I now live in. This is not what you see on TV. This is not what you hear in music. This is not the talk you're going to hear at work tomorrow. Matter of fact, it's pretty much the opposite, isn't it? But God has not called us to fit in. God has called us to stick out. Now, what today's message and last week's message have in common is this. To truly have stronger relationships, you have to lay your lives down. If you want to have stronger relationships, guys, you've got to lay your lives down for the women in your life. Ladies, if you want to have stronger men in your life, you've got to lay your lives down and don't do what comes naturally, do what comes supernaturally. You've got to sacrifice. You've got to give. You've got to put others above yourself. It doesn't come naturally. Matter of fact, it's opposite the spirit of the age, so you're going to need some help. You need Jesus. You say, what are you talking about? I want you to look at what Paul says in the book of Galatians. He says, "I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me," and watch this, "gave himself for me." Jesus did what we must do. Jesus gave himself for us. He laid down his life for us. He did not demand his rights. He gave everything he had for us to save us. Listen, so Jesus then becomes our model of what it means to have strong relationships. We lay our lives down. And the only way you can do that is through Jesus. And doing what Paul said, becoming crucified with Christ, and I no longer live. What's he talking about? He's talking about putting faith in Christ to save them. But he's not just talking about praying a prayer. He's not talking about repeating words. He's talking about embracing the cross of Jesus Christ to a point where I recognize that I no longer live. Christ lives in me. I die to me. I die to self. I die to what I want. That is what following Jesus truly means. It's not a political party. It's not even an ideology. It's a choice to come and die so that I can live. And that's the way we have strong relationships. When we become crucified with Christ, clearly I'm not talking about being literally crucified physically, but in the spiritual sense, I give up my life for Jesus. I lay my life down for Jesus. And there are lots of people in this room that can testify that when you lay your life down for Jesus, you don't get death. What do you get? You get life, eternal life, more than you ever dreamed. So today, I want to encourage you. The doorway to strong relationships is through the cross of Jesus Christ. There are no shortcuts. I mean, no, I could give you lots of information. We could go for weeks and weeks and months and months. I could quote this author, this video, that source. But listen, at the end of the day, it's not about what's in your head. It's about what's in your heart. Let me illustrate it this way. Over my years of being a pastor, I've lost track of how many hours of time I've spent talking to men and women about their marriages, about their homes, about their relationships. And I can't tell you the number of times that those men or those women have told me, "Well, Pastor, I know what you're telling me is true. I just don't do it." What they're really saying is, "I won't do it." Can I tell you that a lot of us, what I'm telling you today, what I'm telling you last week, it's probably not all that new to us. The question becomes a matter of if we will actually do it. If we will lay our lives down, because if we will, God will honor that. Listen, if you know what to do, but you don't do it, can I be honest with you? Now, we're a church that practices speaking the truth in love. I'm not a good pastor if I don't tell you the truth. I'm not here to tickle your ears and make you feel good, because it's the truth that sets you free, amen? And so, but me telling you the truth doesn't mean I don't love you. Matter of fact, it means I do love you. I'm going to tell you the truth. Here's the truth. If you won't do what you already know you should do, you don't have a relationship problem. You have a rebellion problem. Right. You have a heart problem. And you need to get right with God and come to the cross and lay it all down, because the road that you're on is leading to destruction, death all around. God doesn't want that for you. God doesn't want anybody to perish. He wants you to be saved. He wants your life to be saved. He wants your relationships to be saved. And the way that He's provided is through the cross of Jesus. So before we pray for relationships here today, I'd like you to bow your head and close your eyes. And I'm going to ask that no one please be moving at all. Please honor this sacred moment. But I'd like to ask men and women, teenagers and children here in this room today, you say, "Pastor, you're right. I've got a heart problem. I need to make things right with God. I already know what to do. I just won't do it. There's stuff in my heart that's not good. I need to make things right with God today. I want to do more than just agree with God or believe in God. I want to follow Him. I want to pick up the cross of Jesus today and lay my life down, because I want eternal life. I want what God has offered me. I don't want destruction. I don't want death. I want Jesus." Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. I'm going to count to three. And when I say three, I want hands to go up all over this room of men and women who will say, "Pastor, I need Jesus in my life." Perhaps you once served the Lord. Perhaps you've fallen away from God. I don't know. But today, you know God's Holy Spirit is reaching out to you, convicting you, drawing you to Himself, because He loves you. When I say three, I want you to put your hand up, because I want to pray for you. I want to pray with you right there in your seat. I'm going to ask God to save you. One, I want you to listen to God's Holy Spirit. If He's speaking to you, don't deny Him. Don't reject Him. Don't smack His hand away. Just say yes. Two, the Bible says today is the day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. We live in a crazy world. No one's promised tomorrow. Today is your day to receive Christ. When I say three, I want your hand to go up. "Pastor, pray for me. I need to make things right with God." One, two, three. Put it up. Yes, all over this room. Raise them, raise them. Keep raising them, keep raising them, keep raising them, keep raising them. Many, many hands are up all over this room. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. So many of you raising your hands. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Keep raising them, keep raising them, keep raising them. God bless you, God bless you. No one's looking around. God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Those of you with your hands raised, you can put them down for a moment. I want to lead you in a very simple prayer of faith. Not magic words. It's the beginning of the crucified life. And anybody else that would like to join with them as we pray, easily more than 20 raise their hands here today. But you want to join with them as we pray. Pray this way. Say, "Dear God." Come on, say it out loud. "Dear God, thank you for Jesus. I believe Jesus died because I sinned. I'm responsible. I did this. I confess that I'm guilty. Please forgive me. Today, I put my faith in Jesus Christ to save me. I believe Jesus died and rose again so that I could have new life. Today, I embrace the cross. I confess Jesus Christ is Lord of my life from this day forward and every day. Holy Spirit, give me power to serve you every day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Somebody give God praise for all of these men and women that responded here today. Praise God. Now, for those of you that raised your hand, I'm going to ask you to do two things for me. Number one, on your way out at the Next Steps kiosk, we have some spiritual resources we want to put in your hands, some books, a Bible, and encourage you on your walk with God. Because, again, we're not talking about just praying some prayer and just going living the way you've been living. You're on a new journey of the crucified life. So grab that stuff on your way out. We'd love to encourage you that way. Secondly, every Wednesday night, as well as the Family Project, we're doing a class called The Journey, and it's specifically just for people who are recently giving their hearts to the Lord or following Jesus. So I would love for you to join us at 7 o'clock on Wednesday as we learn what it means to grow in our faith and walk with Jesus. Somebody say, yes. That's a good choice. Amen? Praise God. Now, we're not done because I want to pray for the ladies. See what I did there? Can I have every lady stand in this room? Ladies, I want to ask you to pray about two things this morning in light of what we've learned. I want you to pray, first of all, that the Holy Spirit would search your heart and search your spirit to see if there's any of the spirit of the age that is inside of us. And just ask God to forgive us for dishonoring, for words of dishonor. Instead of doing what God says, we do what the culture says. So I want to ask you first, would you start to pray right now and just say, Holy Spirit, search my heart, search my spirit. God, forgive me for dishonoring words. Forgive me, oh God, for doing whatever the culture says and what everybody else says and what everybody else does. God, I pray that you would forgive me. Wash my heart, cleanse my heart. God, I confess my sin. Your word says, if I confess my sin, you are faithful and just to forgive me of my sin and cleanse me from all unrighteousness. And God, we're praying today as women. We're praying, God, that you would give our hearts a heart of honor. Fill our mouth with words of life. Fill our words with hope. I want you to lay your hands on your mouth, lady, and just ask God, God, give me a spirit to prophesy to my sons and my daughters. Give me a spirit of prophecy to my husband, to my parents, to the people in my life. May I speak life to them. May I speak hope to them. May I be a voice of honor. May I be a voice of strength in their lives. God, would you help me to be like that angel, to call out the warrior in Gideon, to call out the warrior in the men in my life. God, use me as that voice. Make me your voice in my house, in my neighborhood, where I work, in Jesus' name. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for that courage and that strength to do just that. And all God's ladies said amen. All right, guys, it's your turn. Stand up, guys. Ladies, you can stay standing. That should cover everybody. All right. Guys, would you stretch your hands toward me today? I want to bless you today. Stretch your hands toward me, guys. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you. May the Lord make you a mighty warrior. May you be a strong man. May you lead with courage and conviction and boldness and humility. May God give you strength to live a life of honor in a world that does not value it. May God's power rest upon you to win every victory, to conquer every foe, to overcome every struggle in your life. May you be a man of God. May you be filled with faith. May you walk with Him all the days of your life. And may God give you victory in every side. I bless you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. And all God's men said, amen. Amen. Come on, somebody, give God praise for what you've heard, for what He's done here in the house of God today. Are you glad you came to church today? Are you glad you came to church today? Did God do something good in your life? Praise God. I want to encourage you. Join us next week. Stronger parents, stronger families. Bring somebody with you, all right? Check out the resource table on the way out. Sign up for Serve Day. We're all serving together on March 19th. Have a great day in Jesus. We love you. God bless you.